the Bible, a book whose origins lie thousands of years ago in the Middle East. It still inspires billions today.
Creation roots us in the wonder of our own drama. What a beginning.
Its teachings provoke controversy.
The Ten Commandments are the hysterical believings of a group of desert tribes.
We know the Bible is completely accurate.
It shows me how dangerous revelation can be.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
Seven figures from different walks of life offer their personal perspective on the best-selling book of all time and what it means to them.
The women of the Bible still speak to us today.
Who was this Jesus Christ, and who was it that murdered him?
Even if you've never read a word of the Bible, your life will have been shaped by it.
In this program, Bettany Hughes goes in search of the women of the Bible.
There's a common consensus that the Bible spells trouble for women, that it's repressive and misogynist, and there is no doubt that some of the pages are rank with sexism.
The proud Queen Jezebel is fed to the dogs. The teenage girl, Salome, is used as sexual bait.
But for me as a historian, the Bible is intriguing because if you read it carefully, you realise that it's not systematically anti-women. And more than that, it offers us an insight to a turning point in history. A moment where women enjoyed extraordinary power, but then that female influence was gradually eroded. It's a profound change that is played out in the Bible by a great cast list of female characters. Because the stories of these women are stories of power and sex, motherhood and the female body, the women of the Bible still speak to us today.
I'm in southeast Turkey, a short drive from Iraq and overlooking the Syrian plains. This whole area is key to the events described in the Bible. Around 3,000 years ago, through the Bronze and Iron Ages, this was a crossroads, an ancient gyratory where Hittites from the north, Egyptians from the south, Babylonians and Assyrians in the centre clashed and traded. Sandwiched in between, but often sent spinning in all directions, were the Hebrews. Much of the Bible is based on their historical interaction with these other peoples, the superpowers of their day. This region came to be known as Mesopotamia, the cradle of civilization. From here spring many of the stories in the Bible, including the creation. It's also where the river Tigris flows, and in Genesis, this river has its source in the Garden of Eden. This is where God created the human race. First of all, Adam, and then Eve, the first woman. Genesis chapter 2. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and he brought her unto the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man." And they were both naked, the man and his wife. And they were not. We're all familiar with what happened next. The happy couple, blissed out in Eden, were told by God not to eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge. Tempted by a snake, Eve did, and so did Adam. He knew exactly what he was doing. He wasn't tricked by his wife. But ever since, Eve has been held responsible for God's expulsion of the happy couple from Eden. From now on, they would have to live in a world of work, pain, and death. And it was all Eve's fault. Her disobedience would be seen as the first ever sin. This original sin would be passed down like some hereditary disease to all generations of mankind.
But original sin is never explicitly mentioned in the Bible. It's actually a much later interpretation, an invention of the 4th century AD. And It only became Christian doctrine on the insistence of the early church fathers. In particular, it was championed by one man, St. Augustine of Hippo. Now, St. Augustine was from North Africa. He was a bishop and a theologian, and he clearly had a razor-sharp intellect, but he was also spiritually very troubled. He saw evil and corruption everywhere in the world around him. It's clear from his writings that he was very tormented by his own sexual desires. Sex and evil, the two perfect raw ingredients for the concept of original sin. Augustine's got a lot to answer for because he obsesses about original sin and tells us that Eve was the progenitor of original sin, whereas that's not really here in the biblical text.
No, I mean, it's a very complicated theological interpretation, and it is rather astonishing that it, you know, had such an effect, that it was so persuasive. There were many opponents of it at the time. And, you know, they could easily have succeeded. It was an argument. It was a moral and theological and philosophical argument. How did sin get into the world? And he hit upon this idea that it was transmitted physically through the genitals. Absolutely extraordinary, really, when you think about it. Sex and death came into the world when Eve persuaded Adam, seduced Adam into taking the apple. So there was this huge emphasis on the sin of carnality, the sin of sexuality.
It's clear in the Bible that the writers of the Bible and those who came after the Bible, the commentators, had a great fear and desire for women's sexuality. And because they couldn't manage both the fear and the desire, they painted women as the source of all evil.
I don't want to play the blame game like the early fathers of the church, but going back to the text itself, it seems that on the face of it, Eve wasn't to blame. It was the snake who was guilty. By tempting Eve with the promise of knowledge, it triggered the chain of events which led to the fall and the expulsion from paradise.
Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, You shall not eat of any tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil.
It's the snake who's tempting Eve, and yet, isn't it true that culturally we think of women as being temptresses? This idea of the temptress is a very powerful one. And in the Middle Ages, in terms of the visual arts, you start to find this tempting serpent actually starting to be given a female face. It's a fabulous example by the 15th century Flemish artist Hugo van der Hoes. And the serpent isn't just a great long serpent with a human face. It's a serpent from the waist downwards, and it's entirely female from the waist upwards, so the serpent is becoming more and more female. It just shows you how this artist, anyway, wanted to put together serpent and woman, so they're half and half, not just all snake with a woman's face.
Woman and snake. It's a deadly combination, or so we're told. But the Bible at no point refers to the snake in Eden as the devil. And there's no mention of Eve committing the original sin. These are much later Christian interpretations. A large part of Genesis was written in the 6th century BC. But more than 600 years earlier, during the Bronze Age, many societies were far more positive about women and snakes. Both were seen as agents of divine powers, of fertility and healing, as well as embodying a particular kind of knowledge or wisdom.
It's always hard not to feel that there is something slightly sinister about snakes. And I'm sure it's partly because of the literal bedeviling of the serpent in the Garden of Eden that we're conditioned to think of them as objects of revulsion. From the earliest sculpted images, women are cozied up next to snakes. And there isn't a hint of a suggestion that this is in any way a bad thing. In fact, quite the opposite. For example, in the Bronze Age, high priestesses grapple with whole handfuls of snakes in order to ensure the fertility of the land and the health of their community. So in the Eve story, where you have a tempting serpent who brings a dangerous kind of knowledge to mankind, what you're getting is a distorted memory of a much older, much more positive order of things.
This older order of things, in which woman and snake were in harmony, lasted for many thousands of years, from the Stone Age and throughout the Bronze Age to the beginning of the Iron Age, around 1100 BC. Before this date, in a number of cultures, women appear to have had more influence, more clout. And in Genesis, there are other traces or folk memories of this lost time of greater female status and equality. You can find them in two accounts which relate to the creation of the first man and woman. We all know about Eve being created almost as an afterthought, a spare part from Adam's rib in Genesis chapter 2. But there's also a far more egalitarian version of this story in chapters 1 and 3.
In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God he made them. Male and female he created them and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. This is clear. Man and woman are created on the same day, from the same earth, equally.
These differing accounts are partly the result of Genesis being set down over a period of time and versions stuck together rather than edited into a single narrative. But what's really fascinating is that the less familiar versions don't even call the woman Eve.
So who is this first woman? Because she doesn't have a name here.
No, she doesn't. We don't know who she is or what happened to her. All we know is that God created out of the earth, God created male and female, God created them in God's image. That's all we know. The rabbis who came after the Bible was written said, well, what happened to that first woman? Who was she?
Rabbis and male commentators decided that this nameless woman had to be wiped off the face of the earth because she aspired to be equal to Adam. She refused to take his orders. They also taught that maybe she wasn't a woman at all, but a demon in human form, Lilith, a mythological creature who'd originated in Mesopotamian culture.
The story of Lilith is built on previous stories that are ancient of a demon called Lilith. As the one who swoops down and devours your children when they are babies in the cradle. One of the images of Lilith is that her hair is uncovered and loose, similar to Medusa's hair in a way.
Poor old Lilith. So she believes in equality, she wears her hair loose, and therefore she must be a demon.
Yes. And the rabbis say, don't tell anyone about the story of Lilith. Because if you do, women will want to be like Lilith. They will also want to be equal. And we can't have that. So don't spread the story of Lilith. And that's worked. Because very few people, Jews or non-Jews, know the story of Lilith.
I'm very glad we're giving her an airing now.
However different the accounts of the creation of the first woman, Eve attracts blame. This reflects the time when much of Genesis was written, in the 6th century BC. By then, in many societies, women and their traditional wisdom had been downgraded. There'd be a further devaluation by the time biblical commentators like St. Augustine got their hands on Eve. But as I've discovered, the text itself is more ambiguous. And with some of the women following Eve, it doesn't hedge its bets, but is downright positive. Enter the judge, Deborah, who leads armies and makes history, and also happens to be wise. In Genesis, the Garden of Eden exists in a time before time, before history. But much of the Bible deals with real historical events. The books of Joshua, Judges, Samuel and Kings form a group known as the Deuteronomistic History. They give an account of what happened to the Israelites after Moses led them out of Egypt and after their wanderings in the desert. They then struggled to establish themselves in the promised land of Canaan, but to do so, they first had to oust the Canaanites. This was around 1100 BC, when the Bronze Age was giving way to iron. The Iron Age was an age of flux, when tribes and city-states and kings all battled to gain the upper hand. History just lurched from one aggressive land grab to another. And through all this pain and bloodshed, there seems to be a quantum shift in the way that women are viewed. It's almost as if they're resented now, because communities don't need wisdom, they need brute strength to survive. Although women were often denigrated as the weaker sex during this time of total war, some still found opportunities to take power and to dispense their wisdom. Such a woman was Deborah in the Book of Judges. She was a judge, meaning not just one well-versed in the law, but a leader and one who was wise.
Deborah is certainly a woman who commanded quite some respect. In the Bible, she's identified as the fiery woman. She's credited with turning around the fortunes of Israel by leading an army to take the land of Canaan. Now, at this time, Canaan was a fairly established society, whereas the Hebrews were just a bunch of disparate nomadic tribes, so a pitched battle was not going to work. But Deborah's soldiers decided on a form of guerrilla warfare. And it was a strategy that worked.
When you don't have strong centralized government and things are in a bit of a ferment, that gives the space for, as it were, natural leaders to rise in the way that Deborah does. And that, I think, would fit well with a time period around about the end of the second millennium, beginning of the first millennium.
And Deborah, the prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, she judged Israel at that time. And she dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in Mount Ephraim. And the children of Israel came up to her for judgment. And she sent and called Barak the son of...
She sat underneath her palm tree at the top of a hill, and the Israelites would come to her, would come up to her, and would seek her decisions. But what's fascinating about that is that they went up to her, and going up in Judaism is a very powerful idea. It means the person who is on the hill is closer to God. And so she was linked in a very powerful way to being a spiritual judge, as well as perhaps a legal judge.
Deborah's also described as a prophet. And now, at this time, a prophet doesn't necessarily mean somebody who can foresee the future. It's more an intercessor on behalf of God, a gifted individual who can hear the words of God, interpret them, and then deliver them to the people. And Deborah chooses to communicate through song. So in Judges chapter 5, we have the song of Deborah.
It says, "All deliverance had ceased in Israel, till you arose, O Deborah. No shield or spear was seen until you arose."
Deborah's song is full of lyricism, but it also includes the story of Jael, one of Deborah's female warriors, who bluffs her way into the enemy camp and kills the Canaanite commander, Sisera. Jael put her hand to the nail, and her right hand she put to the workman's hammer. And with the hammer, she smote Sisera, and she smote off his head. And when she had pierced and stricken through his temples, at her feet he bowed, he fell, he lay down. At her feet he bowed, he fell, and where he bowed, there he fell down dead. These are women that you underestimate at your peril. There might not have been a single historical Deborah, but certainly she was based on the real flesh and blood women who got a result for Israel. One woman in the Bible, also credible as a historical character, got a result for Israel not on the battlefield, but intriguingly, in the bedroom. The bedroom of King David. slayer of Goliath and founder of the great royal dynasty of Israel. There's a story in the Book of Samuel that carries right over into the Book of Kings that starts out as a simple tale of male lust and develops into one of the biggest dramas of the Bible. It features murder, marriage, royal succession, and a woman called Bathsheba. And it came to pass in an evening that David arose from his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. She was also the wife of Uriah, a soldier in David's army.
So Bathsheba's womanly charms are on show. Does that automatically give a man the right to want to have her? It's a moral dilemma lurking in this story. And of course, it's an issue that still vexes us today in both the East and the West. Should a woman be covered or uncovered? And if she is covered and yet you can still see the curve of her breasts or her buttocks or her thighs, is she somehow responsible for manipulating male lust? What is fascinating about this story is that that question is left open. It's really not clear who's to blame, whether it's David or Bathsheba.
Some scholars suggest that she was just bathing in a cooler environment, so rather than bathing inside because it was too hot, she would bathe outside, which was not an uncommon thing. She thought she was in privacy. She didn't know that anyone would be looking upon her. So many see that as an innocent act.
David looked, he saw, he desired, he sent for her. She came, he slept with her, and if you were a woman and you had a summons from the king, what would you do? Would you disobey? Would you have any sense what it was about? So, Bathsheba isn't necessarily the seductress here. I think she's at least, she's sinned against as much as sinning.
Now, this has given King David an embarrassing problem. He's impregnated the wife of one of his soldiers, the mercenary Uriah the Hittite. So he decides that he needs to remove this obstacle from his path. And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter saying, "Set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle and retire ye from him that he may be smitten and die." The king's instructions are obeyed. Uriah dies. And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the morning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord.
They lose the son conceived from that marriage as a punishment, but they have other children, and their other child, Solomon, becomes the next king of Israel. And I think that's also fascinating because it says something about power structures in ancient Israel, which is contrary to what we often think. The heirs to power are often generated, are often determined by their mothers, not by their fathers.
Not only has Bathsheba got exactly what she wants, but by ensuring Solomon's inheritance, she has now mothered the line of David. It's not bad going for a soldier's wife who happened to be having a bath in the right place at the right time. We look to the Bible for role models, but a character like Bathsheba is anything but. Heroine or anti-heroine, she's complex, clever, flawed, human, and an indication of just how non-judgmental the writers of the Bible could be. It's as if they were compiling a casebook study, not just telling a morality tale. However, the Bible can be furiously moralistic when it wants to be. It turned the Phoenician princess Jezebel into the archetypal bad girl and her name into a byword for promiscuity, female cunning, and corruption.
One woman who gets an unambiguously negative write-up in the Bible is Jezebel. Now, she's obviously female, so she's potentially tricky anyway. But far worse than that, she's a foreigner. And a foreigner who brings foreign gods into the court of the Hebrew king, Ahab. And those three horrors combined add up to make the account of Jezebel's life one of the goriest and darkest of all the stories in the Old Testament.
Jezebel was a historical figure, a Phoenician princess who married Ahab, the king of Israel. At this time, women, many of them priestesses, still had a special affinity with the spirit world. So Jezebel brought her pagan gods with her, turning her husband away from the Hebrew God. This strikes me as strong-willed, not a cause for vilification.
Would you call your daughter Jezebel? Probably not. It has such dreadful overtones. In fact, a lot of the tradition, if you like, about Jezebel is pretty unfounded. For example, the idea of Jezebel as a loose woman, i.e. someone who went round, you know, sleeping with everybody and so on. There is no evidence for that within the text. She is accused of carrying out whoredoms and sorceries, certainly, but the chances are that that's actually polemical language, and whoredom was used very widely within, certainly in the books of Kings, to represent worshipping other gods. So it's a metaphor for going after other gods, and it's regarded with the same kind of horror as actual physical whoredom would have been.
She was someone who was what we would call today a fundamentalist. So what she tried to do when she came into the land of Israel as the queen, she wanted to inculcate Israel with her faith and bring in Baal worship.
Jezebel promoted the worship of this mighty god, Baal, and his female consort, the war goddess Asherah. Now, Baal was believed to hurl around thunderbolts and Asherah to have created the gods herself. So, as their earthly handmaiden, Jezebel would have commanded a huge amount of respect.
She serves her people and her gods. And if we were reading a story written by her people, then again, she would be glorified for her action. But we're not. We're reading a story written from our perspective, and therefore her actions are very negative in our eyes.
So, according to the Bible, the Israelites rose up against Jezebel and her religion after her husband had died in battle. The new king, Jehu, tracked her down to Jezreel in the north of Israel. Second book of Kings, chapter 9. And when Jehu was come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it, and she painted her face and attired her head and looked out at the window.
She's a queen, for heaven's sake. If she's going to meet her public, as it were, for the last time, she's not going to stick her head out of the window in rollers and with her makeup smeared. She's going to play the part till the very end.
And as Jehu entered in at the gate, he lifted up his face to the window and said, "Who is on my side? Who?" And there looked out to him two or three eunuchs, and he said, "Throw her down." So they threw her down. And some of her blood was sprinkled on the wall and on the horses, and he trod her underfoot. And when he was come in, he did eat and drink, and he said, "Go and see now this cursed woman, and bury her, for she is a king's daughter." And they went to bury her, but found no more of her than the skull and the feet and the palms of her hands.
And then when they go to retrieve her body, there's only parts of her body left. And there is the idea that she was eaten by dogs, that her body was eaten by dogs. And so she can't be properly buried. So there is the idea that her body was mutilated.
It is an ugly story,
I think we should remember Jezebel as one of the great, powerful female characters of history, and instead she's become the embodiment of female villainy and moral corruption. It's difficult to generalize about the Bible. It spans a huge period of history and has many books open to many different kinds of interpretation. However, there is a marked change when you pass from the Old to the New Testament. There are fewer battles, less smiting for a start. So the Deborahs are thin on the ground, as are the dynastic power games of a Bathsheba. You could describe the majority of the women in the New Testament as more ordinary, humble even. That doesn't make them wet and powerless. It means that they reveal a new, a different kind of power.
Because I've been looking at the strong female characters of the Bible, there could be a justification in not including the Virgin Mary. She doesn't actually have that much of a presence in this book. She's mentioned about 12 times, and the references are fairly repetitive and sparse. And yet, it is that very quiet presence that has allowed her to be all things to all men.
This is from Matthew chapter 2, and it describes the coming of the Magi to Bethlehem.
And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with his mother Mary, and they fell down and worshipped him. They presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh.
Mary gives birth to Christ. She's there at his crucifixion and death. But apart from the flight into Egypt and the marriage feast at Cana, there's precious little else of her. Yet a couple of references in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke would help to turn Mary into a global phenomenon, the most powerful figure in Christianity after Jesus. She's told by an angel that she is pregnant through divine intervention, not because of sexual intercourse. In Luke, it says that she knew not man. So she's a virgin when she gives birth to Jesus, the Son of God. This miraculous occurrence, the virgin birth, was seized upon by the early church and so grew a very special cult.
I mean, the virgin cult, for instance, is not there actually in the Bible. You know, this idea that she was a virgin. It says she knew not a man, okay, but the fact that she was a virgin after she gave birth to Christ, there's nothing about that, but that becomes established as a teaching, you know, relatively early on.
It begins with this emphasis on chastity in the early period, the early fathers of the church, the great exponents, really, of Christian doctrine, St. Augustine, St. Jerome, and St. Ambrose, and St. Bernard of Clairvaux. They all emphasize these moral qualities of Mary as a virgin, and as a paradigm of female virtue, and female virtue very highly coded as sexual.
Virginity had been invested with the aura of the sacred in some pagan religions, so early Christianity wasn't new in venerating Mary as a sort of eternal vestal virgin.
You know, the ever-virgin status of Mary. And that kind of thing she does share with certain other goddess cults of the early Mediterranean world. It must be so, because Christianity emerged as a religion amongst many, and in those other religions there were, of course, these female goddesses, virgin goddesses, and so the Virgin Mary absorbs quite a lot of those traits within her own cult.
It was in what is now Western Turkey that the Mary cult started to become a global phenomenon. A special devotion grew up around her as she replaced the old pagan goddesses like Diana or Artemis. In church doctrine, she went from being the mere mother of Jesus to Theotokos, the mother of God. This incredible theological clout was reinforced by the building of churches devoted to her and by the dissemination of her image all over Byzantium, the Christian Roman Empire in the East.
I did say that Mary was all things to all men. So when the Byzantine capital, Constantinople, modern-day Istanbul, was threatened by Islam after the 7th century, Mary started to take on other characteristics of the ancient goddesses of the Mediterranean. But this time, a far cry from the cults of fertility and virginity.
Mary acquires a character reminiscent of the war goddesses of the pagan world. She's credited not just with spiritual, but with physical power. What would happen is that an icon of the Virgin, and actually a particular kind of icon, one that was thought to be a direct copy of a life portrait done of Mary in Jerusalem, would be used as a defensive weapon. These icons were held at the front of battle chariots, or in the time of siege, they were paraded around the city walls of Constantinople. It was Mary, the mother of God, shielding God's empire on earth with her protecting veil.
Of course, it's the veil protecting Mary's virginity we mostly tend to think of. She has come to symbolise all that is chaste and pure. At the other end of the moral spectrum is a biblical dancing girl associated with impurity and sexual decadence, Salome. She's veiled too in order to dance a striptease, but that detail's not in the Gospels. It's our imagination working overtime. Salome, a name to conjure with, but we only know it through cross-referencing the gospel account of her infamous dance with the writings of Josephus, a Jewish historian who lived and wrote during the 1st century AD. Salome was the stepdaughter of Herod, the ruler of Galilee, and so pleased him with her dancing that he offered her anything she desired. Prompted by her mother, Herodias, the girl asked for the head of John the Baptist. He'd upset Herodias by accusing her of incest and adultery for marrying Herod, the brother of her previous husband. Salome isn't actually given a name in the scriptures, and yet along with Eve and Mary, she's arguably one of the most instantly recognisable of all the female biblical characters. Outside the biblical text, she's become inflated to be the ultimate femme fatale. In our heads, she's not just an unnamed young girl who dances in a royal court, but a sexual temptress who strips in order to bring one man a few moments of pleasure and pain and brutal death to another. She is the stuff both of dreams and of nightmares.
Herodias, her mother, felt wronged by John the Baptist and really encouraged her daughter to dance and then ask this impossible deed, which was for the Baptist, this cult figure, to be beheaded and his head brought in to the feast of Herod's birthday on a platter. It's horrific. It's absolutely horrific. I mean, who could not be sort of intrigued by the perversion of this story and also the ambiguity of it?
The Bible is so cryptic and it's so short. I mean, one of the things that happens when one goes back to read it is that certain scenes about that are very, very famous, like the scene of Salome and John the Baptist, are extremely short and, I mean, really succinct and, as a result, very enigmatic. I mean, very hard to know what has actually happened.
Well, Salome certainly doesn't dance through seven veils in the Bible, does she?
it's a great sort of testimony to the power of human imagination and creative reading, which isn't a bad power. It's good that we project and we embroider and we. It's just what we embroider, what direction we take it in. Mm.
It is good. It's just a shame that we always fantasise about Salome, you know, stripping when she isn't.
It may be that she danced with some, not a veil in the sense that we're thinking later the dance of the seven veils, but with perhaps some garment that she swayed around with. I think that's a reasonable assumption. The main thing is it was clearly very erotic because you could not achieve such a prize, such a trophy as the head of a prophet unless you'd done a pretty sexy dance. But there may be traditions of perhaps Bronze Age dancing, which of infertility, which leads into Salome, but there's no evidence of that in the description in the Bible.
We are such unoriginal creatures, aren't we? Because the fact that still in the 21st century, men will still ask girls to dance with them, and this will, you know, cause enormous ructions, and they'll happily pay the earth for it.
Early form of lap dancing, really.
Yeah.
The last books of the Bible are played out a long way from where Salome danced, as Christianity moved west under the leadership of the Apostle St. Paul. Women played a huge role in this evangelising. There are hints of what was to come in the Gospels with a special devotion of women to Christ, especially Mary Magdalene, sometimes described as the 13th Apostle. She's supposed to have had a pretty checkered past, but in the main, the women in the New Testament don't have the high dramatic qualities of the Old Testament women, but they do feel very real, rooted as they are in the worlds of work and domesticity. Take Lydia, for example, in the Acts of the Apostles, the book recording the spread of early Christianity. Lydia lived here, in what used to be Thyatira, now Akisha in southwest Turkey. She ran a business manufacturing the dyes used for purple fabrics. After she converted to Christianity, her house became a centre of operations for St. Paul and other members of the early church. Lydia appears in Acts chapter 16. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshipped God, heard us.
And she whose heart the Lord had opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized, and her household, she besought us, saying, If ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. Now, the archaeology tells us that this town was actually immensely important in the purple dye-making industry, and also that women here could run their own businesses. I do wonder a little bit, though, whether Lydia has been made up or slightly embellished, because this whole region was called Lydia, so it's very convenient that she's given that name. But isn't it fascinating that she's being sold to us as a paragon of early female Christian virtue? She's a self-made woman. She runs her own household and she's clearly in control of it. And she's certainly a woman who knows her own mind because she embraces this strange, newfangled religion. I do really love Lydia, even if it's only because she's neither warmongering nor caught up in some terrible, lurid sexual scandal. And also her story is very important because it reminds us just how attractive early Christianity was to women and how valued they were by the early church.
St. Paul is often presented as keeping early Christian women down, with his pronouncements about how they should be subordinate to men and covered up. Repressive? Yes and no. Women like Lydia lived in the real world, yet in other ways they opted out, rejecting the pagan social norms. It's easy in hindsight to be dismissive of what we perceive as their meekness and chastity, but these were virtues used bravely as a weapon, challenging the sexual mores of the day. We know that Akisha was a town infamous for its statues of Eros, standing proud on columns like these and encouraging all the pleasures of the flesh, celebrating what could be a very carnal, blokish sexuality. Today, we think of letting it all hang out as freedom of expression. But to early Christian women, this was no liberation, more like a form of sexual slavery.
The pagan world was saturated with sex. Much religious ritual took an erotic form, and sex was on the menu day in, day out. So the fact that so many women flooded to the new religion of Christianity, a number describing themselves as virgins of Christ, suggests that at last this gave them good reason to say no to sex. So rather than us automatically condemning Christianity as a puritanical force,
we should remember that for many women, abstaining from sex was a blessed relief.
The last real woman mentioned by name in the Bible appears in the final book, Revelation. This woman, like Lydia, also lived here in Akishar or Theatira. There, the comparison ends, because she was a Christian convert who couldn't bring herself completely to turn her back on the old pagan ways. Her name was Jezebel, and like the Old Testament Jezebel, she's reviled in highly sexualized language. Not for the first time in the Bible, but certainly for the last, idolatry is adultery, the idolater to be disposed of like so much spiritual filth.
This is the author of Revelation addressing the leaders of the church here. I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman, Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants, to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her, into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the hearts. Now, this woman was almost certainly not actually called Jezebel. So this is probably our first example of that word with reference to the actual Jezebel of the Old Testament being used as a damning form of abuse.
Alas, libi badonai, rama carni badonai.
So, the Bible is bookended by women. Eve at the beginning and Jezebel Mark II at the end, both of them sold to us as bad girls. But if you read this book carefully, you realise that their stories are actually much more complex and ambiguous than that. Just like Bathsheba, they cannot be put into neat moral boxes. It's a reminder that the Bible itself is not as rigidly anti-women as some people think. But for me, the real value of this book is that by featuring the likes of Deborah and Jezebel, we get to meet the flesh and blood women of the distant past. This is a rare window onto an age of transition, when women were losing their standing. And while they were being written out of history, the Bible writes them back in. I think the Bible is not just a spiritual guide inhabited by role models, but can be read as an epic of women in all their glorious, messy humanity.
In the next programme, Gerry Adams investigates the life and death of Jesus.
There may be many people who would wish that I was entombed forever.
Who was this Jesus Christ? What did he do that led to him being executed in this very, very brutal public way? And who was it that murdered him?